This episode was sponsored by REN, a website where you can calculate your carbon emissions. You can also sign up to make a monthly contribution to offset your emissions or support rainforest protection projects. Tardigrades are famous for their capacity to survive. If you look them up, you will be inundated with long lists of the many things that scientists have thrown their way to see if the tardigrade will survive. We've made some lists like those ourselves. Tardigrades on the moon, tardigrades in extreme heat. You've heard about them, we've talked about them. What else is there? Well, here's a surprising fact you might not have known. For certain species of tardigrades, like the one in the middle of your screen right now, you can tell the difference between a male and a female by looking at their toes. That's right, the toes. These tardigrades are called Milnesium, and the males of these species have a pair of claws on their feet that are shaped a little bit differently from the rest of the claws, with only one hook on each claw instead of the usual two. But after taking a closer peek at this tardigrade's toes, we can confirm that she is a female tardigrade. Now that's a fun fact for us as we watch this clip, but it does not actually do anything for the poor rotifers that are surrounding this tardigrade, who are currently stretching themselves in and out of danger. Around the tip of a tardigrade's mouth are small bumps that we think act like little sensors, and when those bumps make contact with a rotifer, out pops the tardigrade's stylet, a little needle that pokes out from the tubular mouth opening. That stylet pokes into the rotifer, and from there the tardigrade uses a circular structure called a pharynx in its head to create strong suction. And then the stylet goes from functioning as a needle to functioning as a portable built-in straw that lets the tardigrade suck out the inside of its prey. You can see some of that bodily fluid leaving the rotifer as the tardigrade's stylet pumps away like a beating heart. And when she is done, the rotifer remains like an empty coffee cup. This method of eating works quite well for the tardigrade, letting her eat quickly from the prey that is directly in front of her. But not all organisms come equipped with a weapon that lets them turn rotifers into Capri Suns. These organisms have to turn to other methods to extract nutrients from their food. This marine ciliate is called Kentrophyllum, and it came to James, our master of microscopes, in a large container full of beach sand. On a normal day, maybe we would talk more about its funny almond shape that stretches as it swims around, but today is not a normal day, because this Kentrophyllum is about to be overshadowed by a rotifer. Now, where is the rotifer, you might ask? It is inside the Kentrophyllum, of course. We did not catch the moment of its capture, when the toxic needles lining the Kentrophyllum darted out and paralyzed the rotifer. By the time we arrived, the rotifer had already been ingested, but it was not dead yet. You can see it wiggling and wrestling at the broad end of the Kentrophyllum, causing the ciliate's body to wrinkle and fold in on itself. But it is trapped inside of a food vacuole now, a compartment that exists to break this rotifer down. Sure, the rotifer can try and fight against the walls of the vacuole holding it hostage, but there's not much it can do against the digestive enzymes pouring in or the increasing acidity of its surroundings. A food vacuole is a hostile place to be, and for minutes, its destructive tools will go to work. In the end, the rotifer will be left in dissolved pieces to be absorbed by the Kentrophyllum cytoplasm, sustaining the organism that was the site of its last battle. It's a lonely death for the rotifer, with only the Kentrophyllum to witness it. Though I suppose now there is also us, sharing and immortalizing that rotifer's final moments. And if the rotifer had not died in the body of another organism, it may have ended up like this Gastrotrich. Now, to be fair, they did find themselves in a very similar situation. They are both dead. But the rotifer was eaten alive, digested from the outside while trapped in another organism. Meanwhile, this Gastrotrich is going through the exact opposite situation. It is being eaten from the inside out by a scavenger called a Peranema. Now, as far as we know, the Peranema didn't do anything to kill the Gastrotrich. It was likely already dead, though we don't know what killed it. But the Peranema is both a hunter and a scavenger. Sometimes it can be found with other Peranema as they hunt down prey in a pack of hungry microbes. At other times, the Peranema scavenges. They are notorious for being able to squeeze their way into whatever holes they find to get into a dead organism, and in this case, the Gastrotrich's exoskeleton was the right combination of available, open, and dead for the Peranema, which found its way in and decided to begin helping itself to the buffet of dead tissue around it. After all, the Gastrotrich won't be needing that tissue anymore, so the Peranema might as well make good use of it. The Gastrotrich's body has likely vanished by now. Perhaps the Peranema will have finished it off entirely, or some other scavenger will have joined in on the fun. Or perhaps it will have simply faded, like the rotifer inside the Kentrophyllum, its body eventually fading into the world that encapsulates it. But for this last moment, let's remember the Gastrotrich in a more beautiful moment under a fluorescent light, glowing in the glorious purple autofluorescence of its remains. Thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. And thank you again to Ren for sponsoring this episode of Journey to the Microcosmos. Ren is a website where you can calculate your carbon emissions, then offset them by funding projects like community tree planting in East Africa, or a project that uses satellite monitoring and drones to detect and prevent deforestation in the Amazon rainforest. We will need a lot of different approaches to take on the climate crisis, and this is one way that you can learn more about your carbon contribution and take some action. You'll answer a few questions about your lifestyle, and they'll also show you ways you can start reducing your carbon emissions. No one can reduce their footprint to zero, but when using Ren, you can offset what you have left. Once you sign up, you'll receive updates from the tree planting, rainforest protection, and other projects you support. And we've partnered with Ren to protect an extra 10 acres of rainforest for the first 100 people who sign up using our link in the description. There's a group of people in the world, and their names are on the screen right now, who really, you know, rather like chill videos about tardigrades sucking the insides out of rotifers. They are our patrons on Patreon. They're the kind of people who think to themselves, you know, I would really like for this kind of content to exist, and so they give us a little bit of money every month so that we can keep doing it, and we really definitely could not do it without them. If you would like to become one of those people, you can do that at patreon.com/journeytomicro. And if you'd like to see more from our Master of Microscopes, James Weiss, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram or on TikTok. And if you want to see more from us, I bet you there is a subscribe button somewhere nearby.